Hello, everyone. Today is my great pleasure to introduce you Professor Emil Prodan from the Physics Department of Yeshiva University in New York. I will just say that Emil is a pioneer in topological mechanical modes and one of the most activities of our association. And Emil will talk today about hearing for topological wave steering. Emil, we're listening to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First, I'm very glad that my name was pronounced very, very well. And thank you, the organizer, for the invitation. Thank to everybody who logged in for the interest. I want to acknowledge funding from the Keck Foundation and National Science Foundation. And later, when I also later, I'll specifically thank my collaborators when I will show the experiments. First slide is, what is the Phason of a generic pattern? And I have a few slides. And I know everybody can figure out what the Phason is for a particular pattern. And even for a particular pattern, it takes some time to figure it out. However, I guess everybody will have a little bit of hard time to figure out what's the Phason of this pattern. And what I'm trying to say is that if you really know what the Phason is, you will have, in principle at least, no problem to understand what the Phason of this pattern is. And to get to the final answer for this one, I'll show some familiar examples, and then I'll put the definition of the Phason, which will look a little bit, would have looked a little bit strange if I were showing it first. I just learned about this process listening to an audiobook in our trips to skiing and snowboarding. It's called a softening phase. So let's look at a very familiar pattern. It's given by this algorithm. So I put down on the real axis, I put points which are come from this expression. We see here a theta, which is fixed, and then a phi, and I'll put here phi to convey that, in fact, well, I'm not talking just about one pattern, but a family of patterns which are indexed by this phi. There is no problem saying that, yeah, this phi, the natural space for this phi is the circle, that is, you go from zero all the way to one, and once you hit one, that's the same as zero. So it's really the circle. However, if you plot this pattern for this is zero, this parameter, it looks sort of like this. So if somebody hands you this pattern, you'll need some time to figure out that it was generated from this algorithm. So here is exactly what I said, a little bit more explicit. Let's acknowledge also that when I modify phi, there is no local changes in the pattern, but rather the whole pattern changes. So for example, if you will try to 3D print this pattern, you cannot just, you have to do the whole job from the beginning till the end. And then let's also look at this interesting fact that if I rigidly shift the pattern so that each point sits at the origin, let's say here now is this point which sits at the origin, but if I pull this point and bring it to the origin, and then I pull this point, bring it to the origin, always rigidly shifting the pattern, what happens is, that's the same as changing phi into phi plus a theta, where a is the label of the point I just brought to the origin. So here is what it means. This rigid shift is just literally relabeling. So for natural reasons, let's call this phi the Phason of the pattern. Now, some conclusion and puzzles. There seems to be a relation, yes, between a dynamical system, which is just rotation on the circle by a theta, and the rigid shifts of the pattern, such that every point gets to sit once at the origin. The question, can we see this from the pattern without knowing the algorithm? I've already mentioned this question, and I show how actually wild this pattern look like. So you will not guess the algorithm out of this pattern. And astonishingly, for me at least, the answer is yes. And this is what I want to explain, how you recover this dynamical system from this pattern alone. And you will see how, in fact, natural and somewhat trivial the whole process is. Imagine I have a generic pattern. So these are just points on the real line. And one x0 always sits at the origin. If x0 sits at the origin, then all I need to know to reproduce this pattern is the distances between near neighbors. So the pattern P is in fact equivalent with this sequence of numbers. Therefore, this pattern, in fact, is a point in this infinite dimensional cube. Let me see, perhaps you wonder why I pass from, why didn't I use x1 and x1, x2, x3, and why did I pass to d0, d1, d2, and so on? As you can see, xn, in fact, is not bounded, while these d's are always bounded. In particular, for that pattern is bounded by 1. And in fact, we always, for patterns which are don't have holes in them, you can always choose a scale so that these distances are in fact below 1. So you choose a unit so that these distances are below 1, which I will do. So then, now this sequence has to coil inside this cube, rather than floating inside the whole R to infinity. Now, if we rigidly shift the pattern, so I take this x1 and put it to the origin, rigidly shifting all the points, and then I choose put this x2, this leads me to a process. And what is that process? Is a dynamical system inside this cube. So this point start to move inside this cube under this shift, and it traces a shape. Therefore, this shape is called psi, and together with this action of rigid shifts form a dynamical system. The statement is that this dynamical system and the dynamical system on the circle are identical as dynamical systems. And as you can see, this is a generic pattern. So something like this exists for any generic pattern. This equivalence happens only for a class of patterns, in particular for the pattern that I have shown. Now let's see, seeing is believing. So I show you some just numerical experiments. I haven't done any deduction or anything. But I have to explain, how do we look at a shape inside an infinite dimensional space? Well, these d's are just coordinates, So let's think of them as just coordinates. And of course, when I have a value for the coordinate, then it's just a value. But let's think of them as coordinates. Well, I have my coffee cup right here. It's a three-dimensional coffee cup, but now you see a two-dimensional picture of it. However, if I rotate the cap around and maybe even up and down, careful not to spill, out of this two-dimensional representation, you will figure out that is really a coffee cup. And here we will do exactly the same. We will just project this shape on different planes. And I can only project on one-dimensional plane, two-dimensional, and three-dimensional plane. And so I will project, for example, into D0 plane, D0 D1 plane, D0 D1 D2 plane. What that means, I shifted the pattern, and every time I collected again the value of these coordinates. I shifted the pattern and collected the value of the coordinates. And I get a sequence of points in these planes, which now I show them to you. So here is the pattern. Here is how that shape looks like when it's projected on the D0 plane. This is how that pattern looks like when projected on D0, D1 plane. So it's a circle, but you will say, this circle must come from a projection of a cylinder. Well, let's look then at the projection in the three-dimensional plane. It remains a cylinder. And then if I choose any planes, let's say D0 and D10, D11 and D17, it will always be a circle. So really, this S1, which we figured it out right from the beginning, is embedded in this infinite space. I can take another example, which again, we can figure out that it has a Phason, but the Phason now lives on a torus because we have two circles. And if we do the same numerical procedure as here, I can see this torus directly from this pattern. So here is if I project that psi on the D0 line, here is if I project that psi on the D0 D1 plane. It's a flat figure, and sure enough, when you project it on D0 D1 D2 plane, you get a full torus. So if I could rotate this one, I could demonstrate you that it is indeed hollow inside and it has a shape. So this torus, which we can see it right away from the analytic formula, we can also discover it from just the pattern itself. So now, after this softening phase, I can put a definition which will not look so strange. Suppose I have a pattern in RD, and one should notice that the pattern can be reconstructed from the vectors connecting near neighbors. Here I should also say that it also can be reconstructed from the Voronoi tessellation. And then you can still parameterize the whole pattern as a point in an infinite dimensional cube. And then if you start shifting the pattern, allowing each point to sit once at the origin, the pattern traces a point inside the cube. The Phason space is really this shape traced inside this process. And this is true for any generic pattern. Now, when the points of the pattern can be labeled by ZD, there is a little bit more to it. You get a whole dynamical system. So you have a map, which goes from Z times Z times Z. So you have D maps, which shuffle this space. So this is the, and if you work out what this Phason is according to definition. To this definition, you will find that it's the same Phason people talk when looking at quasicrystals or quasi-periodic patterns. Now, while the definition is straightforward, computing this the space of the Phason is notoriously hard. Up to 2016, I was working with disorder systems. In that case, the whole is the whole cube. It was very easy. And then I started a project on quasicrystals, working with Johannes Kellendonck, and he's a specialist in quasicrystals, so he can visualize these Phason spaces. But for me, it was extremely difficult to understand what's going on. At the end, I was able to calculate a few of them, and in the general statement is that the Phason for the quasicrystal are contourized tori, so they are not smooth spaces, they are just topological spaces, and they are very fragmented. However, for quasi-periodic patterns in Euclidean space, the Phason are in fact tori, and this tori can be of arbitrary dimension. I'll now give an algorithm, show an algorithm which in fact covers all quasi-periodic patterns. I think there is nothing left beyond this this algorithm, and here it is. One starts from a periodic lattice. The periodic lattice is generated by this AI and lives in the physical space, which is this RD. Now we want to perturb this this lattice, and the perturbation is done dynamically. In other words, there is a dynamical system on this abstract torus which tells me how to move this point relative to the ideal point. And here it how you build this dynamical system. First, you embed this this physical space in a larger space. So remember that at one point we work with a one-dimensional pattern, but the Phason was a tori. So that's precisely how you get a two-dimensional tori out of a one-dimensional pattern. You embed the physical space in a larger space, and then of course you can generate a lattice inside this higher dimensional space, and then you quotient with the lattice that you take mod to the generator of this L prime, and you get a torus. And this action, very simple action of translation by these generators mod the lattice L prime, gives you a dynamical system over this fictitious torus. Now, if you take any function from this tori to the physical space, like this projection, then you get a pattern. It depends on where you start the algorithm on this tori, and algorithm for the pattern is written here. So you use this function, you use this dynamical system, and here is the very explicit form, and I call this pattern a dynamically generated pattern, and certainly it covers any quasi-periodic pattern that you can imagine. So why is this interesting for a metamaterial scientist? The answer is, patterning is very easy. You work with the same sort of resonators. You just change the distance between the resonators, and you let the resonators couple the way they naturally couple, and then you get this kind of spectra. And this, of course, is the Hofstadter butterfly. What is this one over here? In a few slides, you'll see that it's exactly this spectrum, but it's just the form. So a map on the plane was applied, and this one has been done in this way. But this gap over here is the same as this gap. This gap over here is the same as that gap. Each of these gaps can be identified with these gaps. So let me show here. This is a straightforward application of the algorithm. You start from the circle. You have this dynamical system, and you project. Here it's really the same thing, but I chose a function f, which is nothing but sort of a bad lens. And you look through that bad lens on this algorithm, and because the lens was so bad, then the circle has been deformed into something like that. But the two are the same. So what one learns from over here is, I think there is no doubt that everybody sees that these gaps have a Chern number. This pattern will in fact show topological edge modes as you change the Phason. Well, the same will happen here. So what is the Phason? So here the pattern was started from this point, but very well I can replot the pattern starting with a phi, let's say from a certain angle phi, and I can modify that phi along the circle, and that means I modify the Phason, and what happens is the bulk spectrum will not change. So the bulk spectrum is unchanged. Why? Because modifying the spectrum is the same as shifting. Modifying the Phason is the same as shifting the pattern we just seen. And shifting a pattern doesn't, shifting a metamaterial doesn't change its spectrum. So the bulk is okay. But when you cut an edge, let's say here, then it's no longer about shifting. So the boundary spectrum, in fact, depends on the Phason, and the Phason plays the role of a quasi-momentum. So it's not hard to understand that topological edge modes will show up, these chiral modes. And then, now that we sort of saw the equivalence between these two, the same will happen over here. So let's see, how do we see and explain this dynamics? I'm taking my preferred system, which is these spinners, which have the center fixed, therefore they have only 1 degree of freedom, and then you can space them according to various algorithms, and they have magnets over here, so they coupled nicely. Then the dynamics takes in the Hilbert space spanned by the resonances supported by these resonators. There is only 1 degree of freedom per resonator, so here is just one mode per resonator. And then of course the dynamical matrix looks like this. So this is a generic. What we have, coupling between a spinner labeled with M and spinner labeled with M, and the coupling can be mapped in the lab. In fact, we did that experiment, and we do have how these matrices depend on the pattern. Now let's see here, these guys were made out of copper. So there is no influence of these two magnets on these two magnets. So these couplings, in fact, at the end of the day, depend entirely on the distance between the magnets, and they only go between nearest neighbors. However, if this one was made by a ferromagnetic material, then there will be an influence, and then things will not be so easy. The only thing I could conclude is that even between this one and this one will be a coupling, and the coupling will depend on the entire pattern. And this is a very healthy way to look at. So this H are not really coupling coefficients, but rather coupling functions. Functions of what? Of the pattern itself. And the pattern should be thought of as a point in this infinite dimensional cube. Now, if you look at this one, you'll say it's too general. You cannot figure out what's going on, because the generality is too much. Maybe we can get closer to one of these model Hamiltonians, like Harper Hamiltonian, or it's very important, in fact, to stress that no such fine tuning is necessary. So how things go? In one slide, I can explain. There is a magical fact. There is a Galilean invariance principle, which says that if there is no background field here, so these guys are just hanging in the air away from everything else and magnetic fields and so on, then the coupling constants, they need to enter this relation. You'll say that this is a little bit trivial, because it's just shifting. But in fact, I recall that these are two different measurements in the lab. So in the lab, we don't shift the lattice, but rather we change the pattern, and we re-measure the coefficients. And if a pattern happens to be in relation to another pattern like this, then this covariant relation shows up. If that's the case, then something nice happened. I can choose this A to be precisely equal to N, so I can drop one index, and this ugly dynamical matrix becomes this one. And now it has a structure. S is just the shift operator acting on N, returns N plus one. And if you look closer, these are diagonal operators. They all commute. So the conclusion is that all Galilean invariant dynamical matrices belong to an algebra generated by S, that is powers of S, and diagonal operators of this form. You take any function, it's very interesting. This function needs to be evaluated on the Phason space, because you have this shift, and when you shift the pattern, you know by definition that you return to the Phason shift. So, and then you can even calculate what is the commutation relation between this and the shift. You just put the shift here, you act on it with its natural action, and you'll find that putting S on the right is the same as putting S on the left, and shifting this function with one with the tau. And therefore, you shift the argument by a tau, and you don't need any fine tuning, no model Hamiltonians. So if I can calculate this algebra for all cases where the Phason is the circle. So it's the circle, and then the dynamical system is like this. What happens? On the circle, we can decompose this function in a Fourier series, And if you do so, then you see that this TF is nothing but sums and of powers of this operator. This comes straight from the Fourier transform. Therefore, the whole algebra, which looked a little bit large, is generated by this T and by the shift. And now if you calculate the commutation relation according to this rule, this shows up. So this is just the algebra of magnetic translations in two dimensions, which generates the integer quantum Hall effect. And the conclusion is that no matter how wild the pattern is, if this sigma is a circle and this dynamical system is available, the dynamical matrix is always like this. So let's look again, the dynamical pattern generated from the circle. I already showed this spectrum. How about incommensurate double layer? If you take this just a generic dynamical matrix, you can put here any pair potential. In particular, I put this pair potential. A spectrum like this shows up. What we are looking at here, we are looking again at the Hofstadter spectrum, but a little bit modified. Why? It turns out that the whole of the incommensurate, that is the Phason space of this incommensurate double layer, is a pretzel. And you step on the pretzel by a theta. What is theta? Is the ratio between the unit cells of the two layers. And therefore, the Phason space is the circle, but the length is not one, but rather one plus theta. So then if you recalculate the commutation relations, it comes to be that of magnetic translation, but with a theta of that sort. It means this spectrum is the same as this spectrum, but this map has been applied to this spectrum. I'll show experiments which are based on this fact and why, how we took advantages of all this generality. Now, quiz time, can we understand the spectrum of this generic dynamical matrix over this pattern? And in particular, can we conclude that somehow we can generate topological edge modes? And I just work out this pattern to trick you, because the pattern is the same as the one I shown already. It's generated with the same algorithm, therefore but a strong deforming F map. Therefore, the Phason space is again a circle. There is no question that what we are looking here at, it's again the Hofstadter spectrum, and all these gaps can be identified. How we identify the gaps? So that this gap has, they are labeled by two, a Chern number and an integer. So these two labels are unique for each gap. Same labels appear over here. So each gap can be identified with each gap, label by label. I will be going into the 2D, but first I want to show two experiments which take advantage of this. And so many thanks to the collaborators, the lab of Camelia Prodan, Massimo Rusene, Guolian Huang, and kudos to the students, which we all know they do the hard work, Wenting Chen, Mateus Rosa, and Hui Chen. And indeed, these experiments are, once you assemble the whole data in a graph, they look easy, but behind there are weeks and weeks of data acquisition. So here is the thing with the double layer. Now, I already explained things. This is the laboratory realization. And what I want to describe is what's the key thing here. The key thing here is that the layers are in fact, so this is an acoustic crystal. The layers are connected through a spacer. So wave can travel inside this spacer, and this is how we connect the resonators. But you have to agree, we have no way to control how a resonator is coupled to another. If they were in these fine experiments by Kanikaev and Andrea Alou, they have a extremely fine way to actually control the coupling between the resonators through bridges. Now here we went the other way, and we had no way to figure out how is the coupling. And for example, the couplings are not nearest neighbor. They are in fact depend on the local structure of the pattern. Now, why did we go in this regime? We went because this design enabled us to change the Phason very quickly. In particular, as you can see in this movie, if I push it to the right, then I take the Phason on a spin on its Phason space. We have these topological edge modes, which everybody understands. There is a mode which occurs on this end. Then as we push, it's a chiral mode. So as we change the Phason, so here is, we are just walking on the Phason space, which is a circle. The frequency of this mode goes up. At some point, it dives into the bulk. This will be when it dives into the bulk. And it appears, it shows up, another chiral mode shows up here. So if we are lucky that there is still signal left, then this mode will be picked up and brought to the microphone. This, what we are showing here is a result based on the adiabatic theorem, which says that, okay, if we, it assumes that, it assures us that what we will see is precisely the available eigenmode over here. But in fact, what happens is the frequency of this speaker is fixed right here. When is the frequency match between the speaker and the mode is loaded. So you load the mode with sound, and when there is the frequency mismatch, the speaker and the mode is decoupled. From here on, the mode self-oscillates. There is nothing to drive this mode. Now, if this one happens slow, as in the adiabatic theorem, there will be nothing left to get here to the microphone, because dissipation. So dissipation is the foe. Therefore, while the abiotic theorem tells you that you need to slide this one slow, dissipation forces you to push this one as fast as you can. In fact, in the adiabatic theorem, that slow should be in relation to something. What is that relation? Is the time period of the oscillation. So if here we are talking about kilohertz, then that's the scale. That's the reference scale. So you cannot do this topological pumping, which has been predicted by Thouless in the 80s, without being able to take this Phason for a spin extremely fast. So now, if this was coupled with bridges and stuff, you will have to modify each bridge at a time, while in this design, you can modify the Phason by just pushing this upper layer to the right. And we were we were cheering in the lab when we acquired the first data. So this is the first topologically pumped sound through edge modes. It sounds like this. This is the signal acquired. And if I put the frequency of this source in the trivial gap, then it sounds like this. So you should concentrate on the high pitch sound. The frequency is lower, that's why the intensity went down. And you perceive it like down. And the thing that you hear is the friction as we push this one. It's not any sound property. So I am happy to say that the success of this experiment is, of course, due to Wenting. She, everything that you see in this graph comes from her work. And but there is a design element here which is based on no need for fine tuning. As long as you can generate a strong coupling, then you are fine. For the same purpose, I chose this experiment from Massimo's lab. I love it because you can now look and see not directly through your eyes, but at least through the data acquired by the vibrometer, you can see the oscillation in the bulk and also the topological edge mode. And the design is, in some sense, the same as the ALU and the Kanikaev bridges for acoustic resonators, but it enables a little bit more. In particular, you have this mass which you can slide all the way from the top to the bottom. So the variations that you can obtain here are extremely, extremely large. And this is the reason why these topological gaps, in fact, open and they are so large. I think these are some of the largest topological gaps that I've seen. Typically, let me see. Here, for example, you see the topological gaps we could achieve with the size of the topological gaps we could achieve with this type of coupling. And they are small compared with what we see in a relative size. And these are the resonators. Of course, this one has many elastic modes. However, the ones which are prevalent in this frequency range are the ones transverse in plane. I mean, along these resonators. So, in other words, they are transverse to the supporting platform. So in this experiment, the shaker shakes it in this way. So you will see a transverse waves in the gray material. And as you change the phason for this pattern, which involves a reconfiguration of these masses, and you take again the spectrum, you assemble it in such a figure, and the figure looks nice, but this encodes weeks of, I'm not sure weeks, I think in Massimo's case, it's perhaps a day of measurements, but you do see the topological, the expected topological edge modes. Let me again, there is no way to to figure out from the beginning what are the couplings between this resonator and that resonator. The coupling happened through the bending of this platform. So of course, at the end, you can do some sort of an inverse problem from the spectrum. You can figure out a model which fits the spectrum, but that is post analysis. What you want is to make sure from the very beginning that just the patterning here, with no need of being close to Harper Hamiltonian or any model Hamiltonian to achieve these topological bands and topological edge modes. So I'm going quickly over back to, you see my bar, and I was telling Bogdan, let's see how many emails I have until the end, already 10. I'll be very busy after the talk. So I'm going in the two dimension. So I need to remind you what is the algorithm. We have a lattice L in the physical space, generated by AI, and I have a lattice L prime in the fictitious space, which I use it to generate the torus, and I need that because when I calculate the algebra, it will come to be the algebra of magnetic translation in higher dimensions, and the flux matrix, or the what you call the theta matrix, depends on L and L prime. So we need to remember what this lattice L and lattice L prime is. So here are three spectra generated with the algorithm, and three lattices or patterns generated with the algorithm. Basically, I play with L prime and with this function f. And as you can see, I can generate quite a number of patterns. If you look at the spectra, again, you see a bunch of gaps. Are they the same or not? I can tell you that each gap in this can be identified, this gap with this one. They are gap labels, which tells you immediately which gap is which. And therefore, the physics of such gaps are just the same. So these patterns are none. It's just one and the same. Many representations of the same basic pattern, which you, for example, can take this one. So I'll just put this slide. Just communicating facts. We are on the Phason space now. Is the d prime dimensional torus. Therefore, when you do Fourier decomposition, these TFs decomposes in products of, I have not a single T, but I have T1 all the way to TD prime operators. I am in a physical space, which is D-dimensional. Therefore, I have D shifts. They shift in different dimensions, and conveniently, I denoted them with T, and then labels which follow this index here, D prime plus one, all the way to D prime plus D. So the algebra which generates all the dynamic Galilean invariant matrices come from this D prime plus D generators. And if you calculate the commutation relations between these operators, you find that it is again the algebra of magnetic translations in this d prime plus d dimensional space. And as I said, the theta matrix is fully determined by the two lattices. Specifically, if the generators of the physical lattice we start with are in relation with the generators of this lattice through this matrix A, then here it is what you have. So if you if you want certain, now you have an algorithm, so you can produce, you can populate this theta matrix like so, by just varying this A. So the conclusion is that, yeah, we are generating quantum Hall effect in higher dimensions. So this is my last theoretical slide. So I'm going back to the experiments and continue with two examples. Oh, I have this window. Two examples where we put all this at work. We use the algorithm to put down acoustic resonators. The same story, the acoustic resonators, they are connected through a spacer, acoustic spacer. You can see it here. And then if you do a console, full console simulation for the wave propagation, so no discrete modes or anything, you see a spectrum like this. And we were able to actually identify these gaps with the gaps we've seen in those model calculations that I've shown. And now, again, this was on a Wenting task. So not an easy task in these times of COVID. How do you go in the lab? So kudos to Wenting. She pulled out all these tremendous measurements. And what is the advantage of the design? Here, we have a solid material, and the edge, then this solid material defines a nice edge. The corner is over here. And once you put this corner down, you basically fix the Phason. And by moving around this solid material either to the left by 1 minute, either to the right, always between the rows of resonators, you basically change the Phason. So you don't have to re-3D print this one, but you have to only move the boundary. So this is why, in fact, Wenting went on and she 3D printed four of these. And then that together with a shift of the boundary enabled her to sample the Phason space. So that's what we need to do, to sample the Phason space. And here is a console simulation of what happens in this frequency range for a fixed theta, and by varying the Phason on its torus. And what we see, this is a bulk band at the bottom. This is this band and this band. And then in between, we see this very nice structure, which what it should be. It's in fact a whale singularity, which comes from the physics of a four-dimensional quantum Hall effect. When you take a surface, when you take a boundary, the boundary is three-dimensional. While in two-dimensional quantum Hall effect, the edge modes are just chiral modes. In three dimension, the spectrum is a full whale singularity. So what we are seeing here, in fact, for the first time, is this whale singularity mapped for the four-dimensional integer quantum Hall effect. I should say that, of course, we are not the first to realize four-dimensional integer quantum Hall effect in a metamaterial, but we are the first to resolve both space and frequency. So if you look over this fantastic experience with fiber bundles, with the fiber optics, modulated fiber optics, what happens there is you can resolve the you can resolve the frequency, you can resolve the spatial profile of the modes, but not the frequency of the modes. So you cannot map this singularity. And then when Tim took several sections, one across, like so, and another two other one diagonally, and we see the same one appearing in the experimental data. And this will be the cross sections. So it's really an exciting, really an exciting, I was part of it, so I'm not allowed to to self pat myself on the back. What perhaps in the future experiments we'll try to have these gaps somehow open much strongly. Then I'll show a structure from Guo Liang lab. Hui Chen was the main driver here. Now, in this, the Phason, we have one two-dimensional acoustic, and the Phason was living in an abstract space. And in using our mind representation, we changed the Phason step by step, and we realized this one. So in other words, it's a static experiment, and we went step by step. Now here, the Phason has been rendered along this dimension. What happens is then the 2D layer, we should think of this 2D layer being very much like the acoustic resonators we've seen in the previous slide. We have cavities, they are connected. Each of these cube is connected through a bridge, and the size of the bridge has been patterned so that we achieve a four-dimensional quantum Hall effect throughout one layer. And then if we, for each layer, if we use a slightly different Phason, then it turns out that if we analyze layer by layer, it's almost like changing in time, where time goes along this along the z-axis. It's almost like changing in times the Phason. In particular, if you put a loudspeaker in this corner, then you see this corner to corner pumping, which has been already observed in the original original experiment by Odette with modulated fiber bundles. What we have new here to communicate is that, in fact, because the Phason lives on a torus, you can take any orbit from this torus, and you can parameterize that orbit by this z variable, and therefore you change the Phason according to that orbit. Therefore, by this kind of designs, you in fact can explore any orbit, one-dimensional orbit, inside the Phason space. In the process, we also learned that by doing so, in fact, you can don't just do this corner to corner. There are so many other mode steering. In particular, in this experiment, we demonstrated that if you steer the Phason around the singularity, then the mode actually goes around the pattern. There will be a localized mode, and the localized mode is taken by a spin around this one. So this is nothing but an orbit inside the Phason space, and we can witness that one if, for example, we take that particular orbit and render it in this physical space. What we should see a mode which goes around as we move up. What else, and this will be my conclusion, we'll discover here is that not only we can shape the space profile of the mode, but also we have control over the phase of the mode. What it means, as the mode sort of travels from this corner to this corner, it oscillates with a certain frequency, but also it acquires a phase shift, a time delay. And it turns out that time delay is supplied by a berry phase. It's totally controlled by the orbit we choose inside the Phason space. So now I think we are ready to lift it a little bit up and see how we can use that phase control to do interesting experiments with these modes. In particular, if we have another structure like this on this one and we pump from this one, we can do interference, control interference between the modes, and maybe we can slowly penetrate into information processing. So that was my last slide, and I thank everybody for their attention.
Thank you very much, Emil, for the very nice talk and interesting new results, and also for the timing. You did the perfect timing of 1 hour.
Nice.
And now let's move forward to our Q&A session. So we have time for questions, and I think there are a couple of questions. Please, everyone, come forward with your questions. You can raise your hand or write on the chat.